hear a wonderful lecture from our speaker, Leide Lesse. She is originally from Brazil, but considers the United States her home. She attended the undergraduate and graduate schools of the University of Sao Paulo, Brazil, where she studied German, Spanish, literature, and translation. She directed her own language institute for 10 years, and then felt the call for what she considers a much higher service to humanity. So since 1998, she has dedicated herself as a full-time Christian Science practitioner, helping people to find healing through prayer. Her love for Christian Science has never stopped growing, and it led her to become a Christian Science teacher in 2009. And as a member of the Christian Science Board of Lectureship, she gives presentations like this all over the world in Portuguese, Spanish, German, and English. Presumably not at the same time. I know you'll want to give a warm welcome to Leide Lesse.
Really unexpected, but that calmed her down. That She started with a very humble teaching job. But that made her happy because she really knew that her main job was to express love in whatever she did. And very shortly after that, she was able really to maintain herself financially and for the rest and for many years to come. And I know this story very well because that's actually my home story. So that's why we are going to be talking today. So we are going to be talking about ideas that makes us really make decisions that are lasting. Lasting decisions, but decisions that are not made on the brain or on books about making right decisions. Those decisions are really based on our ability to yield to a higher power and really to listen to that voice, as the girl heard it. So, I will be talking a lot about God today, but we need to know that the Bible talks about God in different ways. One of the ways that the Bible talks about God is that God is mind. God is infinite mind, the only creator that creates everything harmoniously and perfect. The Bible also says that God is love, infinite love, that loves all of us unconditionally. And Mary Baker Eddy, the founder of Christian Science, she chose those two synonyms for God, among others, to really define God. And I love to be thinking about God as mind and God as infinite love, because that concept opens our thoughts to really see more easily the wonders of God. But some of you might be here for the first time and might be wondering, okay, what is Christian Science? Maybe I have never heard about Christian Science before, or maybe if you know Christian Science, how can we redefine Christian Science? So let's think about this together a little bit. What is science? How would you define science? So that's a real question.
Knowledge.
Knowledge, very good, because actually the word science is synonym is knowledge. Very good, thank you. What else?
The way things work.
Uh-huh.
How things work.
Yes, how things work. Okay, we can say then that science is a knowledge that show us how things work, which means that show us how we can have that knowledge, and in this case, a spiritual knowledge, that will bring results. So the Merriam-Webster Dictionary says that science is a method reconciling practical ends with scientific laws. In our days here, those scientific laws are actually spiritual laws. And the knowledge of those spiritual laws will bring results. So what about Christian? How would you define Christian?
Following Christ.
Following Christ, exactly. We can also say that we are Christian if we follow the teachings of Christ Jesus. And everything that is Christian is based on Christ Jesus' teachings. Mary Baker Eddy, the founder of Christian Science, also says that Christian is the highest style of man. And I love that definition because it really helps us to see how we can get those teachings of Christ Jesus, apply every day, and live with style. Really living with modesty, with love, with compassion. So we can then think that Mary Baker Eddy used Christian Science, this term, really to explain to all of us that there is a method, a knowledge, a principle that is actually a system of knowledge, we can say, or that we can put into practice and get healing results, but everything based on Christ Jesus' teachings, based actually on the Bible, completely on the Bible. Mary Baker Eddy explained the science, this Christian science, or the science of Christianity, in her book, Science and Health with the Teaching of the Scriptures. And once we understand the principle of the science, of this spiritual science, we actually understand more easily how it was possible for Jesus to heal and to see and to do things that are based We need to understand the science that is contained in those two books, and the Bible, and science and how it will teach the scriptures. But it's a spiritual understanding. And when we develop this spiritual understanding, we are really more easily able to yield to this divine power, to listen to that still small voice, like the young girl listened when she did it, and then we can make right decisions. Actually, this term, still small voice, first appears in the Bible. Maybe some of you are familiar with it, right? Yes, exactly. It appears in the first book of Kings, chapter 19, when the prophet Elijah was actually fleeing from the Hebrew people. They had broken their covenant with God, and Elijah was being persecuted, and he was afraid of his life. So he wanted to see God. So he went to Mount Horeb in the hope of seeing God. And when he got there at Mount Horeb, and I can just imagine that he was really eager to see God, what was the first thing that he saw? Do you remember? The first thing was a wind, a very strong wind. So when after that strong wind was gone, Elijah knew that God was not in the wind. After that wind, what came?
Earthquake,
exactly. So you can imagine how afraid maybe he was. Some of us who have experienced an earthquake, we know how it makes us feel, right? So after the earthquake, he knew that God was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire came. And we know how people were afraid of fire. Remember, not so long ago, we had those wildfires in California? And we know how people might have suffered from those fires. So we can just imagine how Elijah was when he saw that kind of fire.
Sounds a little like a volcanic eruption, doesn't it?
Yes, exactly. So, and after that, when this fire really ceased, there was peace. Elijah felt at peace. And he heard directly from God what he needed to do. Afterwards, it came so clearly to him what the next steps must be, and he followed it. He was protected, he was safe, and he did the right things. So, this still small voice, I'd like to think that it's a voice that all of us can hear whenever we need to make decisions. But this voice is not human. This voice is really a divine utterance. Other translations of the Bible say that the still small voice is like a whisper. Other translations say that it's a soft breathing. Another translation says that it's a soft whisper of a voice. So all those three definitions, and also thinking about still small voice, it gives us an idea of something peaceful, right? So whenever God speaks to us, and God does in a way that we can understand, it's always about peace. It's always to comfort us. But you might be asking, okay, what does it take to listen to this still small voice? I want to listen to this still small voice. What do you think?
Humility.
Humility? I agree. I also would say that humility is so important. What else?
Stilling the tumult of your own thoughts.
Very good. Stilling the tumult of your own thoughts. Sometimes our thoughts are really going too fast, right? And then we're not able to make a decision. So I would say that humility and stilling our own thoughts are so important, because when we are humble, we are willing to do not exactly what we really want the most, but we are really able to listen and to do what God has planned for us. To listen to the divine mind, because the divine mind knows everything, plans everything so good and so perfectly for each one of us. And when we are humble, we are able to more easily listen to that still small voice. We are able then to have a pure heart, pure thoughts, purifying our thoughts and calm our thoughts down, right?
We get so
So this is still a small voice. It's really a divine utterance, so it's not human. This is still a small voice came to the prophets, to several prophets in the Bible. It came to Jesus. It came to others in the Bible. But it came also to Mary Baker-Eddy, the founder of Christian Science. And she really loved the Bible, and she studied the Bible very much. And when she was studying the Bible and listening to that still small voice, it came to her so clearly that the true essence of God is completely good. She didn't make that up, but she, reading, as she studied the first chapter of the Bible, Genesis 1, at the end, it says that God created everything, and everything was very
good.
So she knew that the true essence of God was good. That there is no evil in that essence. That there are no troubles. That there are no no illness. No doubts. There is only good and only peace. So for me, understanding, first accepting, and then understanding that the essence of God is completely good, that is what makes us really understand the science of Christianity that is in the Bible and in science and health. But because this is a divine science, we need to develop a special quality, I would say. We need to develop our spiritual sense. Spiritual sense enables us to see how mind sees, and to listen how mind, how divine mind, speaks. So Mary Baker-Eddy gives a wonderful definition of spiritual sense. Would anyone please like to read the short definition? It's very short. Who can read aloud, please? Yes.
The conscious constant capacity to understand God.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. So let's ponder a little bit about this. If this quality, if this spiritual sense is conscious, is a conscious capacity, when do we express it? When do we feel we have it? When we are sleeping? No. When we are?
Awake.
When we are awake, when we are alert. If it is a capacity that is constant, is it? Can I say, oh, maybe in the future I will have it? No, right? If it's constant, it's a quality that we always had, that we have it now, and that we always will have. So this capacity to understand God is so important. The more we study the Bible, the more we are going to really know and feel that God is divine mind, that God loves us unconditionally. So we can always grow in this understanding of God. We can always learn how to express God better and how to feel the love of God in our lives. So when we develop this spiritual sense, we can really see beyond a human situation. We can see things that the human eyes sometimes doesn't see it, that the human eyes sometimes don't see it. We can also listen to that still small voice that guides us to and help us to be ready to take the right decision or to take the right steps to make the right decision. So when we develop our spiritual sense, we are able to understand God spiritually. We are able to also think metaphysically, which means beyond the physical senses. We are then not limited to the physical senses, and we can more easily perceive God's creation. And perceive God's creation is always good. And then when we do that, we are really able to listen to that gentle whisper. So that it always talks to us. So we always have this spiritual sense. We always have had, and we have it now, and we always will have, but sometimes we're not very much aware of it. So, as I mentioned, this is such a beautiful day. You could have done something else instead of coming here, right? Nobody promised you $100 to come here, right? I would say that it was your that really made you come here. Because your spiritual sense guides you to do something that will benefit you somehow, even when you don't know how. And your spiritual sense also enables you to see beyond a situation. For instance, when you look at this picture here, what is the impression that you have when you look at here? What does it tell you when you look at this picture? What do you feel?
Abundant power.
Abundant power. Very good. What else?
Beauty. Plenty.
Plenty?
I mean, look at how much water.
Yes, look how much water. Make abundance. So it never stops. Thousands and thousands of gallons per minute are pouring down on those waterfalls. Abundance, exactly. Power. You see, this was your human's, your spiritual sense. Your spiritual sense enables you to see beyond the picture. Your human sense, or your human eyes, just tell you, okay, there are waterfalls here. There is a rainbow. There is some green. But your spiritual sense enables you to see beyond and to feel it. So that's why it's so important to develop our spiritual sense when we are thinking about making decisions. Mary McCready also says something very important about the spiritual sense. And she relates the spiritual sense with a better life. But let's see, another volunteer, please, to please read the sentence for us. Yes, please.
A spiritual sense, if spiritual sense always guided man, there would grow out of ecstatic moments a higher experience and a better life with more to about self-abnegation and purity.
Very good. Thank you. So, again, let's pause for a few seconds here and think about it. As I said, spiritual sense leads to a better life. But I would say a better life, it's not about having a bigger house, having a new car, having more money in the bank. There is nothing wrong about having that. But a better life, it's something that comes from within. It's something very special that we all can have it. But in order to have this better life, we need to use our spiritual sense all the time and live a life with more than about self-abnegation. Oh, we don't use this word very often, right? Sounds very biblical. But what is self-abnegation? What do you think?
Self-sacrifice.
Self-sacrifice. Sacrifice gives us an idea. Oh my gosh, what is that? Do I want to sacrifice myself? Yes, this is one of the synonyms. But let's go a little beyond that. Because God doesn't want us to suffer. Huh?
The negation of personal sense.
Oh, very good. He said the negation of personal sense. We talked a little bit about spiritual sense, right? And then now he's talking about personal sense, and we talked also about the physical senses. So the personal sense, really, as the word sense, think a lot about self, about the personality. So when we take away this personal sense, then we can have a self-abnegation, a life with more self-abnegation. I love to think that the self-abnegation also helps us to be selfless, right? To really be thinking of others. So, and what about purity? Why is purity important in the 21st century? What does the Bible say? And some people might think, oh, the Bible is not so important. Well, of course the Bible is important. And the Bible is very, very much for this day. So we need to relate the teachings of the Bible to our lives. So one of the Beatitudes that Jesus gave on the Sermon on the Mount talks a little bit about purity. And it says, blessed, and blessed is also a synonym for happy. So blessed or happy are those with pure?
With pure in heart.
Yes.
For they shall see God.
Exactly. Those who are really, who have a pure heart, can see God. Like Elijah. Elijah wanted to see God. And I think we all of us want to see God. But see God with spiritual eyes, we
really means feel the presence of God whenever we need to make decisions. So when we develop our spiritual sense, we can have a better life as we live more unselfishly, as we think about blessing others and know that by blessing others, it's natural that we are blessed. So that's why we take self out of the way. And then we can see God and we can feel happy. But there is more about spiritual sense. I think this next sentence by Mary Lee Reddy also unpacks why spiritual sense is so important for us and for humanity. Another volunteer, please. Yes, please.
Spiritual sense moves human consciousness into eternal truth.
Very good. Thank you so much. You see, here, Mary Lee Reddy talks that spiritual sense, as we develop our spiritual sense, we are benefiting not only ourselves, but actually humanity. Because spiritual sense lifts human consciousness. Not only our own thought, but human consciousness. And into what? Into eternal truth. Who doesn't know why we're here? Who doesn't want to know our purpose in life? Who doesn't want to know what can I do so that I can really make a difference in this world, right? So the spiritual sense helps us to understand that. And then we're going to be able to make right decisions whenever we need to. I would say that Christ Jesus also used a lot his spiritual sense. The Bible doesn't tell us much about Jesus when he was a little boy, but it says that he really followed God's guidance, and he grew up with wisdom and grace. Who wants more wisdom? When we express more wisdom, are we going to make right decisions or not? Of course. And what about grace? Grace is another biblical word. What does it mean to live with grace?
Important to really follow Jesus in everything that we do.
And Jesus loved God. Jesus loved God so much. And Jesus did things that for our physical senses, for our eyes or ears, sound like really impossible. For example, he multiplied bread and fishes for multitudes, not only once but twice, only with a few loaves and few fishes. And he fed multitudes. Another time we needed to pay taxes. Do you pay taxes? We have to pay taxes. We love our country, so we pay taxes. Jesus knew how important it was to also support the country and support others. So he also paid taxes. But he didn't have money. What he was going to do? So he called his friend Peter, who was a good fisher, and told him, Peter, please go there and fish a fish. And then the first fish that you get, open its mouth, you're going to find a coin. And with that coin, you will pay your taxes and my taxes. How is this possible? How was it just because Peter was a good fisher? No, of course not. I think, and I am pretty sure, that this was possible because Jesus knew the spiritual laws that governed harmoniously the whole universe. Jesus knew one special law that is the law of demand and supply. If there is a need, there is a supply. And he also understood the true reality of existence. In that true reality of existence, there is no lack. There is enough for everyone. The grace of God, as our friend mentioned, also showed us if there is a need, God will supply us, will guide us to find that supply. So this spiritual law of demand and supply is available to all of us whenever we need to make any decision. Mary Magdalene knew that, and Mary Magdalene knew also the importance of follow the steps of Jesus. And she wrote this, another volunteer, please. Yes, please.
Like our master, we must depart from the material sense into the spiritual sense.
Very good. Thank you so much. Like our master, and our master is?
Christ Jesus.
Christ Jesus, exactly. Like our master, we must depart from material sense. Why? Because material sense limits our view. Material sense shows us only darkness, only something that is not good. Material sense tells us sometimes that we are incompetent or that we have too many things to do and not enough time. But spiritual sense, on the other hand, really shows us that there is infinite love, infinite supply for all of us. And when we think supply, I'm not thinking just about money, okay? I'm thinking about ideas. I've learned since I was a little girl that I might have really empty pockets, but I'm always wealthy of ideas. So, and I think this is very helpful to us, that ideas really guide us to the supply that we need. So, material sense also leads to dishonesty. But spiritual sense leads to honesty. And Mary already says that honesty is a spiritual power. And dishonesty is human weakness. So nobody wants to be weak. We always want to really take advantage, I would say, or express this spiritual power, which is honesty. Mary already also knew that. And but when she was a little girl, she couldn't go to school very often, and she had to be home a lot of time. But she loved her Bible. So she spent a lot of time reading the Bible. She also spent a lot of time writing poems and reading other things. Her brother Albert gave her good books to read by philosophers, and she read those. But for me, the most important thing that she did during her adolescence and young adult years was that she listened to God. So when we are sometimes in the middle of so many things and need to make important decisions in life, and our thought is, like you mentioned before, so busy,
How much do we listen to the heart? This is a question that we always can ask ourselves. Am I listening to God enough? I think we can never listen enough. God is always speaking to us. Actually, Christ, the manifestation of God, as Rachel Science explains, is this utterance, this divine utterance that constantly speaks to our consciousness and thoughts of good. Mary made ready during the time that she was really ill. She was looking for ways to find help. And she looked into those alternative methods of healing during her time, such as homeopathy, allopathy, and hydropathy. But she didn't find healing in those. But she had that scientific mind, and she wanted to know scientifically how would be the connection between health and God. So that's what her true quest. And I have no doubt that it was her spiritual sense that enabled her to read the Bible in such a way to really understand the spiritual reality of existence as life eternal. To see existence with different eyes, knowing that existence doesn't depend on human body, on financial condition, or on geographic limitations, but existence is really spiritual. Actually, the Bible teaches us that we are all spiritual. The Bible, the first chapter of Genesis, says that we are the image and likeness of God. Remember that? So, but if we think that God is divine mind and God is infinite love, how can we think that we are the image and likeness if we have a body? So it might be a little bit complicated. So let's see if we can simplify this and use our spiritual sense. So the first thing that I would like you to think is that an image is never different from the original, right? Okay, so then we know that mind is the original and love is the original. But when you think of yourself, when you want to see your image, those gentlemen, when you want maybe to shave, or we girls, when we want to put some makeup on, where do you look on our image? In the mirror, exactly. I have a mirror, right? So, from today on, I would like to ask you, every time that you look at the mirror, that you look at the mirror using your spiritual sense, that you see yourself in a different way. For instance, let me give you an example, but I need another volunteer, please. Is another volunteer here?
Please.
Just to reach two sentences, not much. I promise I won't ask you to come here in front so I can talk about you. Yes, thank you so much. Okay. Could you please read the first sentence for us?
I'm patient, loving, and lovable because I reflect divine love.
Very good. You see? Then, hold on a minute. So this is like a prayer. So we know here that divine love is the original. How many times have we made decisions by impulse? Have you?
I have.
Right? So it is important that we express patience when we need to make, when we want to make right decisions. So it is important that we pray and patient, longing, lovable, because it reflects the divine love. So then we have another sentence. Could you please read the second sentence?
I'm intelligent, wise, and capable of making right decisions because I reflect the divine mind.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. You see, again, we know here that the divine mind is the original. And if we want to make right decisions, it is important that we know, that we accept, that we know with understanding that we are indeed the reflection of divine mind, the expression, like a thought of divine mind, and therefore we are intelligent, wise, and capable of making right decisions whenever we need. And whatever situation you might confront, please think of what qualities are important for you to make those decisions. And
and just put those qualities right here. The most important thing is that you use the second part of the phrase, because I reflect divine love, and because I reflect divine mind. And that's really a short prayer that we can always use. Another thing that is important when you are using your spiritual sense and want to know more about yourself is to know that the true nature of man includes dominion. And I have seen through my practice of Christian Science that dominion is our ability to be governed by divine mind, or we can also say that it's our authority over our physical senses, over limited views, or over personal wants. So we do have this dominion, this capacity, this ability to be governed by divine mind all the time. So let's make another analogy to understand more about our true selfhood, our true identity. Have you brought your ID today? We always would use our ID, right? So what does our ID tell about ourselves? How does it describe ourselves?
Age.
Eye color, hair color.
Sex. What else?
Address.
Age. What else?
That you're capable of driving legally.
Okay. Does it read our name? Yes. Okay. So let us think of those three things: our name, date of birth, because you mentioned age, and our acts. What does it mean? The name in the Bible. If you think of name, think of what happened with Abram, who became from Abram to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah. Then we have Jacob, who became
Israel.
Then we have Saul, who became
Paul.
Yes?
Your name is your essence.
The name is your essence. Very good. So the name in the Bible talks about our nature, who we really are. That's why our essence. And so in those cases in the Bible, they change a perspective. They change how they were viewing something. And then they really saw things differently, using their spiritual sense, and they got a new name. So every time now that you think of your name, think of your essence, of your spiritual essence, of your spiritual nature. Then we have date of birth, or age, as you mentioned. So spiritually speaking, when were you reborn? When were you reborn, spiritually speaking? Do we have a date?
No date.
Spiritually speaking, we always existed, and we will always exist. We were never born, we will never die. Spiritually speaking, as an idea of divine mind, we always coexisted with divine mind. So that's why we are not afraid of birth, we're not afraid of death. We know that there is only divine life. We know that our life is eternal. So the third point was our address. What is our spiritual address?
Kingdom of heaven.
Oh, I love that. The kingdom of heaven. Yes. Whatever we are from, whatever we are today, whatever we will be next week, in a year or two, we are always in the kingdom of heaven. That is our spiritual address.
Or you could say we're in mind, for it says, in him we live and move.
Exactly. Or we can say we are always in this divine mind, because the Bible tells us, in him we live and move and have our being. Thank you very much. Very good. So I would like you to be thinking now, every time when you see your ID or when you are around, think of your spiritual ID. Think of who you really are. That will always help you to make right decisions whenever you have to. And just as a little souvenir, before you leave today, I just brought here a reminder, okay? So before you leave, you feel free to take one of those cards that talk about your spiritual ID, your name, date of birth, and address, and also the two phrases that we talked about as short prayers. I have some here, and the usher will have some at the end. Okay, when you leave. So, Christian Science really teaches us to see our spiritual ID, our spiritual identity, as our spiritual essence, always pure, always good, always loving, incapable of doing violence, incapable of doing something wrong. Because spiritually speaking, we are always one with the divine mind. Mary Brady knew that, and by knowing that, she was able to heal herself. Through the study of the Bible, she really discovered the science of Christianity. She understood how Jesus was able to heal and how she could be healed. She was healed of a chronic indigestion problem, and she was also healed of internal problems that could be fatal. It could have been fatal. So in her book, Science and Health, on page 184, there is also a description of a healing of tuberculosis that she performed when one person was just expected to die. So, but after she discovered the science of Christianity, she was able to heal for more than 40 years. And if we read this book, Christian Science, a biography, Mary Great Christian Healer, it brings over 300 documented healings that she performed. So she was a successful healer. But if we read other biographies, such as the trilogy of Robert Hill, or a shorter one, A World More Bright, we can also see what a loving and a loving person she was, and how she was always using her spiritual sense and turning to God, divine mind, to make decisions. And Mary Baker Eddy was able to do that, was able to heal. How? How was she really able to heal? Because using her spiritual sense, she was able to really calm her thought down. She was able to feel at peace. She was able to pray, and prayer in Christian Science is really listen to the divine mind, to that Christ who speaks to our consciousness, and she was able to listen to that gentle whisper. And she discovered in the Bible the science of divine metaphysics, the science that goes beyond physics. And she could then see, using her spiritual sense, the spiritual reality of life and of health. Especially when we have to make decisions about our health, how we can take good care of our health, it's very important that we use our spiritual sense. And because it will guide us to really go to God and to see our spiritual perfection, to see ourselves, to see our essence as completely spiritual, pure, and perfect. But maybe some of you, have you ever felt depressed, or have you ever felt sad a little bit or angry sometimes? I think we all have. In those times, it's so important that we feel the love of God and that we keep expressing that love. Because divine love governs and corrects everyone. Divine love is the true healer. So it is so important to understand God as divine love. And this science requires us to read those books, the Bible and Science and Health, with so much love. We study the words thoroughly, but we imbibe the words, we imbibe the spirit. And we feel the love of God that comes to us through those words in those books. And to give you an example of how Christian Science really heals and how these books help us to heal, let me tell you an experience. As Larry mentioned in the introduction, I am a Christian Science practitioner, which means that I help people through prayer. So a few years ago, I got a call in the night, and it was by a woman who was in her 9th month of pregnancy, and she told me that for a week she had not felt her baby move. So when she told me that, I knew immediately that I had to make the right decision now and then. At that time, it was important to really understand to know that God has created all ideas, not human bodies, but spiritual ideas, always pure, beautiful, and perfect. So I asked her to call me every 20 minutes and that I would be praying. And then her mother called me on her behalf every 20 minutes. So she got to the hospital, the doctor made some procedures and said that she needed to do an immediate cesarean. So she went through a cesarean, a baby girl was born. And after the baby girl was born, the doctor also did some procedures with the baby. And then he came back and he said, I'm so sorry, but there is nothing that we can that can be done, and the baby will not survive. So the doctor gave up. But the mother, the grandmother, and myself, we didn't give up. We knew that we need to just dig deeper to know more about this love of God, this infinite love of God that loves all of us unconditionally, to know about God as life, that the origin of life does not depend on how the body works, that health is a condition of divine mind, not a condition of human body, and it doesn't depend on parents, on blood, on human functions. There is another sentence in Science and Health that says that divine mind really governs every function of the real man, and man in this case is man as a spiritual idea. You know, man, women, kids, everybody. So I need to know that. And we knew that, we kept praying. And so medicine couldn't do anything, but they were just observing the baby. We all could see the baby girl getting better and better and better. 10 days later, she went home with her mom. A year later, there was a gathering at the hospital, and the mother came with the baby girl on her arms, and the doctor recognized the mother. And when he saw the mother, he looked at the baby and said, oh, the miracle baby, because medicine could not explain how the baby survived. But of course, we made the right decision at the right time. We knew and we opened our hearts to accept with a lot of humility, as you mentioned before, that the only expression of life comes from God. That life depends only on God. That God is life itself. And every one of us is just the expression of God, of this divine life. So it is important to open our hearts whenever we need to make right decisions. So the more we understand about our spiritual essence or our spiritual identity, the more we know about our spiritual nature and develop our spiritual sense, the more we contribute to a more emotionally balanced and healthier society. Do we want a society that is better emotionally and physically? We do, right? Especially emotional nowadays. A society that doesn't criticize, but a society that can also see beyond the picture. A society that's more loving, inclusive. We all love that. I love the banner outside here that really says, welcome foreigners and refugees. I really felt welcome when I saw that. Even though I'm not a foreigner anymore, I don't consider myself felt very welcome. So it is important that we develop our spiritual sense, because when we do that, it's also easier to live with more moral standards. It helps us to express dominion whenever we feel that maybe we are going to be violent or aggressive or raise our voice when we are discussing with somebody. Our true nature is always loving. It's always patient. Romans says that God is a God of patience. So we can always grow in this understanding of patience, and we can always love more and be more patient with others and with ourselves. And when we develop our spiritual sense, the same way that a flower turns to light, we can also turn to the light of Christ, which means to that light that comes from God that shows our way perfect harmony in a peaceful way. So let me tell you another experience that was very important to me. When I was 14 years old, I always loved to, you know, exercise. So I went to the gym as I used to go, and it was a Saturday morning, or end of the morning, you know. So during that time, it closed, I think, at noon or something, and I didn't realize that I was there too long. And when I looked around, nobody was there, and I said, oh my gosh, I looked, and it was already closed. And I said, oh, what can I do? So I got my things, and I went to change, and when I got there, the owner of the gym, a strong man, you know, much taller than me and strong, came closer to me, and he said, oh, honey, you're so cute. You're so beautiful. I don't want to harm you. And he came closer and closer to me. So I knew about Krishna science. I started studying Krishna science when I was 12. And that picture was not good. And he wanted to do a lot of things. And he came over me, and I was just knowing that God was with me, that God was protecting me, that I could not be harmed. And he also, as a child of God, could not harm me. And I said no, and he was very strong, but I said no, no. And somehow, I was able to escape. So I went and I ran, I took my things, and I ran. I never came back to that gym, of course. But can you imagine how I felt? Only 14 years old. And that guy was actually maybe 20 years older than me, but he was also the boyfriend of an older cousin. So I saw him another time in family reunions. But Christian science helped me to see my spiritual essence, to see that I could never be harmed, and to see others as God's children not able to harm me. I could expect that. And somehow I decided that I was not going to be a victim. You might have seen or heard maybe the speech that Ali Raisin said not so long ago. And you might have heard what happened with this Me Too movement and what happened with the doctor of the Olympic gymnasts. And during her speech, she said, I am not a victim. And that's exactly how I felt and how I feel. Christian science enables us to see beyond the picture, remember? And whenever a picture says that we are a victim, we can know that we are able to express the dominion, see beyond. And when we express our God-given dominion, our authority over our thinking, over our actions, over our words, we are able really to make decisions that really lead us to be protected and safe. So another example that I have to tell you is when I was 21 years old and I was living in London. We were talking, we sat in a circle, and there were all Brazilians, and we were talking, and all of a sudden, a guy just from the opposite side of me took something from his pocket, and I noticed that he made a cigarette of pot. And he put it on his mouth, he lighted it, he smoked, gave to the person next to him, who also smoked, and so forth, until when it came to me, I got that cigarette and gave it to the person next to me. And they said, Luigi, how come? Aren't you not going to try? You're going to feel good. It's nice. So you're going to feel relaxed. And I said, I already feel good and relaxed. And I was able to talk to them about how this relaxing feeling and how happiness comes from within, comes from our knowledge of God as mind, God as our, really our Father, Mother, who protects us all the time, who gives us whatever we need, as the gentleman said before, whenever there is The grace of God shows us the supply. And we were able to talk, and I am very grateful because they accepted that my decision. And I was very grateful that on that night I was able to express the meaning. And not only on that night, but other nights. And that expression of the meaning really helped me to make the right decision right there, but then other times in my life. So that's what Christian Science really does to all of us. Christian Science, the study of Christian Science, the science of Christianity, helps us to see good around us and not be afraid of people. That's also another lesson that I had, that I know that man is incapable. True man, the true essence of man, makes everyone gentle and unable to be violent or to make a crime against us. And I had seen also proofs in my life. So Christian Science helps us never to feel like a victim, because we see beyond. We know that God is always with us. And the feeling of victim can always be healed. And when we study the science of Christianity, we understand how we can love unconditionally. And Jesus was a great example of that. Remember when he was on the cross? He prayed on the cross, right? Do you remember what he said when he was on the cross?
Father, forgive them.
Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Right? So the fact that Jesus forgave those who are trying to kill him, I have no doubt that helped him in his process for the resurrection. So forgiveness is always so important. And it's forgiveness that makes us feel stronger and not like a victim. It's forgiveness that helps us really to love unconditionally. When we use our spiritual sense, we are able to say no to those bad feelings. It might be feeling of a victim, or feeling of being lost, or feeling of being overwhelmed, or of not knowing what to do. When we develop our spiritual sense, we are able to really connect to the divine mind and to do what the divine mind tells us. Whenever you need to make a decision, please take time. Ponder and pray. Don't make any decision based on impulse or on personal opinions. God knows what is best for you. God knows how you can take the next step and find lasting solutions. God's enabling you to find inner peace and also inner happiness. So, whenever you need to make decisions, please calm any sense of anxiety. If you are still anxious, don't make any decision. Wait until you gain inner peace. And when we live according to moral values, like I have been trying to do all my life, when we live according to those moral values that the Bible teaches us, we are blessed, we are protected, and we feel safe. And if we have done something bad in the past, or if we see people who are doing bad things around us, we can always, like Jesus, love and pray, Father, forgive them. We can let Christ, the manifestation of God, really guide people and guide us. Because Christ, the manifestation of God, this divine utterance that speaks to our consciousness constantly, Christ guides, transforms, and regenerates all of us, without exception. So another personal experience that I would like to share with you that also explains this a little bit is that, also as Larry mentioned in the introduction, I had a business for about 10 years. I had an institute for languages, a language institute. So because my main language was German, I received some support from the institute, and I went to Germany to spend a few months there to study and know more about German culture, to learn more how to train teachers, etc. So I left everything organized in my school, and I went to so good looking. Probably the woman got him, you know, as his clothes and said, lie with me. But Joseph was a man of moral. Joseph was a trustworthy man. He knew that this was not right. He knew that this was not right for God and for his boss, for Potiphar. So then what did he do?
He ran away.
But you know, clothes were not like ours. What happened then? Yeah, she ran her his clothes. So can you imagine how furious she was? Joseph was just a slave, right? So when Potiphar came, she said, look what kind of slave you brought us. So what did Potiphar do?
Put him in jail.
Yes, go to prison. So he went to prison. Joseph was innocent. He had done nothing wrong.
Hell hath no fury.
Exactly. But he was there for 2 years. And he was always helping. You know, even though he was there, he was always helping others. He was doing this, doing that. And then he would say sometimes, oh, remember me, okay, if you go away? But people wouldn't. But 2 years later, Pharaoh had a dream. And then nobody could interpret that dream. And some guy said, oh, maybe that young Hebrew man can tell you. So they called Joseph. What happened? Exactly. With that humility that you mentioned before, Joseph was able to use his spiritual sense, listen to that still small voice, and he told Pharaoh the meaning of that dream. Pharaoh saw his integrity, his intelligence that really came from God. And Pharaoh put him as the highest man under every head, in charge of everything. So Joseph regained not only his freedom, but also his dignity. So you might ask me now, but lady, what this story has to do with your business, right? Remember I started talking about this because of my business? For some reason, it came to me that maybe at that time when Joseph looked at Potiphar's woman or wife, maybe he was afraid, and that's why maybe he ran. Then it came to me, I cannot make any decision based on fear. I realized that I had to overcome my inner fear, my fear of failure, my fear of not having enough to pay to pay all my employees and over 30 teachers that I had. Can you imagine not paying their salaries? So I needed to know that there is indeed a spiritual law of demand and supply. I needed to expect that for my business, that divine law of demand and supply was available for my business right there. I didn't need to go to Brazil for that law to be available. I needed to know that. So I prayed more, I felt calm, and then it came to me to stay in Germany, and I did. And you know what happened? That woman who was disrupting everybody, she decided to leave. So peace was restored and supply came naturally. So that's happened when we open our hearts to Christ. Christ enabled Jesus to see God's creation, and God and Christ, the manifestation of God, enables us today to purify our thought and our thoughts about others as well, and enables us to see God's ideas reflected in everyone. Christ also brings transformation of thought, and whenever our thought is transformed, we really see healings or solutions. We see healings like the baby that was healed, or we see solutions like in my school. You might be asking, okay, we're talking so much about all of this, why and how you can talk to about this. So everything that I'm saying today really came from my study of those two books, the Bible and Science and Health by Raleigh. And I can assure you that Christian Science is not what some people have asked me about it before. So Christian Science is not a positive thing. vibrational science, for me, the way I feel it, gives us a 360 perspective. It shows our spiritual freedom. Like Joseph felt, I'm sure he must have felt that he was also free, even during those 2 years that he was there in prison. Because that enabled us to find a way out. Even though when we are facing a situation that makes us feel limited, we need to know that we are spiritually free in order to demonstrate that in our lives. So Christian Science doesn't prohibit anything, doesn't judge or condemn anyone, and Christian Science really helps us to see our spiritual freedom and to experience healing in all aspects of our lives, and to demonstrate mental, physical, and emotional health. But you know, you don't see things like this on the news, right? News are telling us all the time that we live in a very confined world with a lot of wars, with a lot of injustices, with a lot of lack. But remember, when we use our spiritual sense, we can see beyond the picture. So every time now that you see, that you read news on your cell phone or your computer, on the newspapers, on TV or on radio, remember that you can use your spiritual sense and see beyond that situation. And you can contribute to a solution so that this situation somehow can change and bring harmony to everyone involved. Especially nowadays, it's so important that we read good news because there is much talk about fake news nowadays, right? But this is not new. Sometimes history just repeats itself when we study history, right? So that happened also during Mary Reagan's time. In the late 18th century and 19th century and beginning of the 20th century, it developed here in this country what was called yellow journalism, or what we might call today sensational journalism.
Muckraking.
Pardon?
Muckraking.
Yes, exactly. So, people were talking, she was a very well-known woman, and people were reporting untrue facts about her and about her life and her church. So she knew that it was important to have good news, good researched, true news. So she founded the Christian Science Monitor. The Christian Science Monitor really reports with well-researched evidences and always tries to look for something good that sometimes is not so easily visible. And I know that it's a small and you might not be able to see this chart here, but it says that the Christian Science Monitor is right here next to NPR and next to BBC, saying that the monitor and those newspapers are a great source of news. And nowadays the monitor has also the Monitor Daily that you can also get from your phone and listen to a summary of the news every day, and it brings a wonderful perspective of the whole world. So let's summarize what we have talked today. We talked about the spiritual sense, our conscious constant capacity to understand God. We saw that Jesus used his spiritual sense when he needed to really make use of this spiritual law of demand and supply, when he needed to feed the multitudes and also to pay his taxes. We saw the story of Joseph, who also used his spiritual sense to interpret Pharaoh's dream, and then he regained his integrity and his freedom. And we also heard about Mary Reagan, who is the founder of Christian Science, Science of Christianity, that is also completely explained in her book, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures. And this book and Christian Science shows us that we are spiritually free, that God created us spiritually free. So we have our spiritual freedom that we can always use up. So now, I really think that it's our turn to use and develop more and more our spiritual sense. The more we develop our spiritual sense, the easier we'll go see beyond the picture, and then we will help to bring solutions to problems around the world. and to problems in our households, or problems within, or problems that we might face in our job, or whatever it is. So I really would like to invite you to develop more and more your spiritual sense, and to really pray every day and every time that you can for yourself and for the world. Because when we do that, when we pray in this way, in prayer here is really listening directly from the divine mind, we are then part of the solution. And we are not just criticizing, but we are really part of the solution. So if you are here for the first time, or if you would like to know a little bit more about the church that sponsored this talk today, the church is really just a few blocks down this direction, and it is First Church of Christ Scientist Raleigh. And they offer Sunday services in Sunday school at 10 a.m. They also have Lexi testimony meetings, and in those meetings at 7:30, people relate how they have studied Christian Science and how they have been experiencing spiritual healings in their lives. And they have a wonderful reading room, also not far from here, that is open Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and Saturdays from 11 to 3 p.m. And in the reading room, you can buy Christian Science literature, or you can also just go there and search the Bible and do some research on spirituality. So I thank you very much for being here today, this afternoon. It was my pleasure to be with you. There is some literature on the back, and please don't forget to take your marks, okay? There's a written.